Hi everyone, my name is Jumi Korkut. I am currently a PhD student at Princeton University. I want to present to you today the Proof Theory Builder, a web-based graphical proof assistant for Sequent calculus, and also for Hoare logic for simple imperative language. Today I want to give you a quick demo of how this works and how it handles the edge cases and how what kind of a user experience it gives to the students. So when you open the Proof Theory Builder, you see in the middle this white space, that's a workspace. And on the left you see the list of current proofs that you have, of which we have none right now. And on top you see a bar that consists of certain buttons. So to start with a Sequent calculus proof tree, we click on the Add LK Goal button. And this gives us this text box for us to type a goal in. So suppose we want to prove P implies Q implies P and Q. And notice how just below the text box, the system parses the goal that we want to put in. So if we make an error, for example, like this, then we get a parser directly in here. So we know exactly what we're getting in the goal. So suppose we want to prove this, I click on OK. And then I have this incomplete proof tree here. So this is sort of like a vector editing experience in the way that you can move your proof tree, you can zoom in, zoom out. And if you have multiple, you could also move them around. So suppose you want to prove this. So this is an incomplete proof tree. You start from the goal and you build upwards. But clicking on the button plus here, you can see all the possible rules to apply. And here you want to apply the implies right rule. And we do. And it is applied. So here we want to apply the implies right rule again. And we got that. And now we want to apply the and right. And it is applied. And these are just the identity rules. So this is a simple Sequent calculus proof as it is done by the users. So this is sort of inspired by the whole driven development style of certain interactive theorem provers like AGDA, or certain programming languages like Idris or Haskell. This idea goes back to mid-90s. And another inspiration for this is, of course, structural editors, which go back to 70s and mostly 80s. So I wanted to create a proving experience that, based on proof trees, that imitates that, the usefulness of that. So what are the other buttons that you see here? So for each proof rule applied, you see two buttons. There's a minus button and a scissors button. So the minus button just unapplies everything that you did above that line. So if you made a mistake and if you want to go back and erase the applications of rules that you have, it's a useful feature. So let's have some of these again just to show. So the other button that we have, the scissors button, cuts the proof in half, separating from that line. So I click on this, and it's asking me if I want to detach the proof at this rule. I do. So now we have two proof trees. This is the initial proof tree that we had, and this is the part that we added later, and then we separate into two. So this is useful if certain people are proving something together and one person wants to prove like one side of it and the person wants to prove the other side of it. And then they can combine these proof trees. So as you see on the left side, now we have two proof trees listed here. So using these, you can keep track of how many proof trees you have in the workspace. And to combine the proof trees, you just drag the one on top and drop it on the other proof tree. And notice how, as I go in, the border of this goes yellow, which means this is attachable again. So I do this and ask me if I want to attach, and I do want to attach. So now I'm back to where I started. So these are the sort of editing actions that you have with proof trees. Also, you can delete entire proof tree, you can save it as a file, and you can also copy the LaTeX output for this proof tree, the code that will render the LaTeX version of this proof tree. In fact, let's try that. So I click on this, it is copied to my clipboard, and now if I go to a LaTeX file and compile, I get the proof tree that I want. So what kind of edge cases that we have for this? Let's try that. Or what kind of error messages that we get for these things? So suppose we were here, and instead of clicking the right implies rule, we clicked on the left implies rule, and we get an error that says, you know, there's no formula for with the implies connective on the left hand side. Or if we had a different kind of goal, such as like P implies Q or R implies S, it's not provable, but we can write, or we can try to prove it. So suppose we want to apply the right implies rule for this. And for this one, you get a question, a prompt from the proof instant, which says, like, which rule do you want to apply this on? So you can pick one and you can move on. Or if you have a goal with quantifiers in it, suppose you want to say for all x, or let me not put this in for now so I can show you something. Px implies px, that's obvious, but notice how when it parses here, it is parsing this part as one. But we don't want that. So we can see the output here, and we can add the extra parentheses that we need. So now this is what we want. Okay. So now this is something with quantifiers. If I want to start proving this, I have to click on the right for all rule. And this rule says enter a fresh variable to substitute for the variable currently bound by for all quantifier. We can just say k, whatever. And we get what we want. So with extra prompts, whenever the proof assistant needs extra information about which formula to apply rules on, or which quantifier, like how the quantifier should be transformed, it gives you prompts, and you enter the extra information to keep going with the proof. Okay, so I also want to show a different feature of the proof tree builder. So as you can see on the top right side, we have this button that toggles between learn and automate. This is because the proof tree builder comes in two modes, the learn mode and the automate mode. You want the learn mode when you are learning which rule should be applied when. And in the automate mode, let's go back to this example again. In the automate mode, when you click on the plus button, you don't see the other rules anymore. You only see the rules that are relevant. In fact, let's go back and see this again. See, you have more rules. So here, you can kind of tell from what formulas you have on which side, which rules you can't really apply. And this is sort of obvious to follow at this point. Or in the automate mode, you also have this extra button called auto, which does a simple proof search. It's not very clever, it's just brute force in certain ways, and it stops when it has some kind of ambiguity about which way to go in the proof. But for this simple example, it can prove it automatically. Okay. So I also want to show you a Hoare logic proof. Okay, now suppose you want to prove a Hoare logic goal for a simple program. So I click on the Add Hoare logic button, and then it asks me to enter a Hoare tuple. suppose I want to prove a simple program. Let me write this. So suppose we want to start from truth being the precondition, and then we want to say if true, then x is assigned to be 3, or x is assigned to be 5. And as a postcondition, we say x is equal to 3. So just by the fact that the conditional here, the condition of the if statement being true or truth, we should know that x ends up being 3. So I press an OK, and then I get my incomplete proof tree. So I want to proceed with the proof. I click on the plus button, so I can apply the conditional rule, or I can apply the consequence rule. So let's apply the conditional rule. And then we have multiple subtrees. So now the rule for the assignment, so when I click, I get the assignment rule and the consequence rule. The rule for the assignment requires the left side to look similar to the right side in certain ways. And then we're going to substitute one thing to get the left side. So for that, I have to apply a consequence rule. So I say, suppose this is just 3 equals 3. And then we don't need a second formula for the consequence rule. And this is the proof tree that we get. Here we can apply the assignment rule. I'll get back to that later. So on the right side of this big birth tree, we have another assignment statement. Here, let's notice on the precondition we have truth and not truth. So we can give whatever kind of formula we need to get the assignment rule going, and then we can just discharge the proof on the left side. So another consequence rule application here. Here I want to say 5 equals 3. And we don't need a second middle formula. So here I can just apply the assignment rule again, and that's good. So now what we have here, as if you press plus, you see left connected rules and right connected rules and the structural sequent calculus rules. So this is actually the whole reason behind this proof assistant, because inside Hoare logic proofs, you may need to do sequent calculus proofs. And our system, by composing different kinds of proof trees, and assisting you with actually proving these in these systems, helps you write these proof trees easier than before or on paper. So how do you prove these? One problem we have with this is we don't have any equality rules for anything in our proof system. So just using the proof rules that we have, we cannot discharge this rule. Also, if you're writing a Hoare logic proof, most of the time, this part is not what you're interested in. So we added this feature using Z3 that when you press, it generates an smplib file and runs that in Z3. So there is a version of Z3 compiled to WebAssembly using mscripten. It is currently about 19 megabytes or so that is actually loaded in browser. But we can just run it inside our browser like this, just on the client side. There is no server. There's no server-side communication about your proof goals. And we can do the same thing for the other proof tree here. And that also says green. So notice how if the goal, if Z3 finds your goal to be valid, then we put a green line over your proof. So this is sort of meant to be sort of a pseudo axiom, as I call it, not a real axiom. Like, users know that this is not a real proof tree. But this is not something we care about proving right now. But we just want to check if it's correct using other automated reasoning tools. and that's what we use this feature for. I also want to show you a different use case of the Z3 rule. Suppose the user wants to prove a goal like f of x equals f of y implies x equals y. So for any f, x, or y, f is injective. So we know that this is unprovable, but if we try to prove this, if we press plus and then Z3, we are going to get this this prompt back. It's going to say Z3 says no to the goal, and also puts a red line over the goal, as you can see, and then it gives a counterexample. So this is a counterexample that Z3 is giving us. The proof tree builder is just parsing this and showing it to the user. But pedagogically, it is useful. If the student tries to prove something that is incorrect or unprovable, they can find the counterexample using the Z3 rule. I also want to talk a bit about the programming effort behind this project. It is a web-based proof assistant. It was written in JavaScript using certain JavaScript libraries such as Fabric.js for the graphics, and Peg.js for generating a parser from a grammar, and Z3 and Z3 WASM to be able to run Z3 in the browser. And as you can see, the project is open sourced. You can feel free to use it or to contribute to it. If you have any questions about using it in a class, you can reach out to me. At Princeton, we are using this proof assistant in the automated reasoning class. It was written by me and a couple of friends of mine for the same class as a final project, and I have developed it a lot since then. Professor Kincaid has told me that the midterm results were about the same compared to previous years when the software wasn't used. I realize this is just a simple observation, not a proof to demonstrate its effectiveness, but it might help. And also, he told me that students haven't asked any questions about how to use this tool, which I take as a positive point about its usability and ease of use. I'm happy to answer any questions. Yeah, thank you very much for listening.